acompañe. For thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory and the lifter of my head. Father God, we thank you tonight for being the lifter of our head. Your glory is always with us. We thank you, God, for this privilege. Be with us tonight in our study. We pray in the name of Jesus. Bless persons that are gathering. We pray for those that are yet to gather. We pray, God, as we look into the word, that you will feed us from on high. And we thank you, O God, tonight. Give us fresh insight. Give us new applications that we can be better witnesses for you in Jesus' name. Strengthen somebody, we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. We just want to have one announcement and get right to our study. Of course, this coming Sunday at RCG is Father's Day. We appreciate all the fathers. And then, of course, on the fourth Sunday of this, actually, Friday the 24th, we will be at the church Friday night, the 24th of June. We'll have six different speakers. We call them our youth and young adult. And many of them, of course, are millennials. But they're going to be available Friday night at the church for our SHIP series. S-H-I-P. SHIP series. Each one of them will have a presentation on the ships in the Bible. Relationship, fellowship, stewardship, leadership, friendship, and discipleship. So tune in RCG Facebook Live on Friday, the 24th of June. And then on Sunday, which is the 26th, we will have our celebration service for our young adults. And our guest preacher is going to be Elder Angel Key. She will be our preacher for that Sunday morning. That's the fourth Sunday in June. All of this information is on our website. Please go there, rcgministries.org. We look forward to seeing you either in person for Friday night or Sunday, or at least visit us on social media, Facebook. One final note, all of our Facebook postings are available on YouTube as well. Following the Bible study tonight and the services that we've already had, 1 hour later, they'll be posted on YouTube. So please share that with your friends. Tonight, we want to look at what I call how relevant the Bible is as it relates to inflation. And the topic is inflation or famine. And right now, we are in the midst of inflation. And we're going to talk about what inflation is in a minute. But we want to look at scripture because I want to start with scripture. Get your pen and your pencil ready because God has given us some good insight. Now, basically, before we look at the economical term or the term as it relates to economics, basically, it's an imbalance of supply and demand. Basically, that's what inflation is. We have an imbalance where the need is greater than the supply. And as a result of that, the prices are affected. So since the need for gasoline is higher than the supply of gasoline, so the price we pay is more. Now, having said that as a backdrop, in 2 Kings chapter 6, 2 Kings chapter 6, and this is sort of a gruesome story. 2 Kings chapter 6, beginning at verse 25. 2 Kings chapter 6, beginning at verse 25. There was a great famine in Samaria. And behold, they besieged it. So in other words, in Samaria, that's the northern kingdom, they came under attack and they took over the city. And because they took over the city, it was a famine in the land. Now, a famine in biblical times was basically when God took away something to punish his people for disobedience. So if you Google famine, I've got a couple examples of famines where God say, because you did not honor me, I'm going to send a famine in the land. One of the most well-known famines is when it came down to Elijah, and because he shut up and it was a great famine in the land, he shut off the fountain, shut off the water. And that's one of the ones we know about with Elijah. And we found out in the middle thereof with the king and Jezebel, there was a famine. But in this case, look at this. A donkey's ass. In this passage, there was a famine. The need for food was greater than the supply. The need for food was greater than the supply. So a part of a donkey's ass, as it says in King James, was on sale and it was sold for 40 pieces of silver. That's a lot of money for a piece of the back of a donkey. That's a lot of money. But because it was a famine, the people would pay anything to get something to eat. And then not only that, a fourth part from a dove. Now, a dove in this case eats seeds, and they would excrete seeds, and they would eat these seeds, but they also went for 5 pieces of silver. Ordinarily, they wouldn't eat either one of these things, but because they had no supply, but they had a need, so the prices of the stuff that they normally don't eat was very high. One more example. The famine was so severe, and this is a really sad situation. Look at verse 26. And as the king of Israel was passing upon the wall, there cried a woman unto him, saying, "Help me, O king, help me." So the king said, "How can I help you?" Verse 27. Now I'm just going to paraphrase the rest of this for the sake of time. The famine was so bad that these two women came together, and look at verse 29. "Why are you crying?" the king asked the woman. Verse 28, I'm sorry. The woman said, "Give me your son. We will boil your son and eat him today." You're talking about a famine. So the woman gave her son, and they boiled him, and they did eat him. I don't know how old he was, doesn't say. And then the next day, according to 29, she said, "Okay, I ate my son. Now let's kill your son and eat your son." But that woman said, "No." So now she's appealing to the king. Can you imagine a situation so bad? A famine? Basically, inflation. the desire for food was out of sight. The demand for food, but they couldn't get it. They had to resort to cannibalism. One woman's son is eaten. The next day, the other woman would not kill her son so they could eat. And when you read this story, you can read the rest of it, 2 Kings chapter 6. I'm just making a point that how bad the famine was and how in scripture, it's just a repeat of today. Things are so out of sight. The demand for everything is so great that we as humans would do anything. Look at the baby formula. Now, of course, it's a little different story, but we couldn't get it. The demand for it was greater than the supply, which made the price we had to get it from other countries. Now, so that was a famine. Would you say that the baby formula was a type of famine? Now, I know the situation is different. They had to close the plant down because of health issues, but the bottom line was it wasn't there. And what did we do to try to get around the lack of supply? So we're now in this inflation, and the same principle is there. The demand is great, but the supply just isn't there. You can look back in scripture. There are many, 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 many Old Testament situations where God sent the famine to teach them a lesson. They had a great need, but they had no food. You look at what's going on today, we have a great need and we're lacking lots of items. Now, let me come to the day. I'm going to get back to the scripture in a minute. We have something called the GDP. G like girl, D like David, P like Paul. It's called the gross domestic product. That's what we have in the States. They used to call it the gross national product, but now it's called the gross domestic because that's what we have here in the States. It's the value of goods and services that are produced in the United States. That's important. It's the price of goods and services produced here in these United States. So whenever somebody produces something, they sell it to somebody else. That person receives it because we got the goods, we turn it to products, and we sell it. Now, the GDP should rise every year, and that's what makes the U.S. so strong, because we have a very strong domestic product in all the things that we produce, and either we buy it from a production or we have something we sell, somebody else buys it. So there's always a buying and selling. Now, we come to this thing of inflation. I'm going to ask you a question. Remember when we received stimulus checks? We needed them to jumpstart the economy. Because of COVID, production had stopped. We weren't producing stuff, but yet we received cash. So when we received cash, there was nothing being produced for us to receive the cash. That is important. Some of the economists suggest that because we receive this money, more than $1 trillion made its way to personal bank accounts. But no products, no services. It was just free money coming in. but no productivity. That upset the scale. Now, because we had this money, and it did help, it really did. So we had the money, right? But there was no products being made, no productivity. So soon, because we had the money, prices began to increase because we had a level of cash, which was the object of the stimulus to get money flowing back into the economy. But prices were going up because we had the cash, but remember, nothing was being produced. So we have something with supply and demand. The demand was still going up, but the supply chain and everything else associated with producing the supply chain was disrupted. So what happens is it's called inflation. When we have an abundance of money, we got jobs, the unemployment rate is low, we've got cash to spend, but because there's little goods, the price of the goods we buy costs more because the productivity is not there. The product isn't there. Case in point, we have money, but we pay more for gas because the productivity for gas is down. Whether you want to say Ukraine or whatever the reason is, that's what inflation is. When the demand exceeds the productivity. In the Old Testament, the demand for food was greater than the productivity, was greater than what was available. Supply and demand. I'm saying that because even now, when we look at it, now the Federal Reserve is going to help us out. And this is important. The Federal Reserve is going to help us out. There's something called demand pull inflation, where we're pulling on the market. Then there's cost push, where the cost pushes us to inflation. But that's not the case here. The contributing factor to the inflation now is the increase in money supply. You see, we've got funds. Job rate is low. We had the stimulus checks. We have got money, but there are worker shortages, supply chain disruption. We gotta pay more because of the supply is low. That's why they talk about inflation, getting it under control. Now, the feds say we're gonna raise the interest rate. Now just stay with me a second. The feds, that's the Federal Reserve Bank. The Federal Reserve Bank. There are 12 Federal Reserve districts. We're in the 5th Federal Reserve District, which is in Richmond. The Federal Reserve Bank is the bank that banks borrow from. So in other words, all the banks, Bank of America, Wachovia, Chase, or whatever commercial bank, PNC, those banks, they bank with the Federal Reserve Bank. So the Federal Reserve Bank is the banker's bank. So the Federal Reserve changes the borrowing rate. So the Federal Reserve tells Bank of America, Wachovia, and all those whatever banks, this is the rate you're going to charge for loans. So the Federal Reserve raises the rate, the interest rate. So somebody said, well, if we're in a season where the supply is not there, but we got all this money, why would the Federal Reserve raise the rate? And see, this is where it is. They raise the rate because they want to make it harder for us to get money. They make it harder for us to get money. That way we won't borrow more money to spend more money on a supply that's not there. So by raising the rate, if you know, if you go to the interest car rates are going up and mortgage home rates are going up. Why? Because they're trying to slow the economy down. They're trying to make it harder for us or the economy or the citizen. If they make it harder for us to get money, then we won't get money to spend on items that the supply chain cannot produce. That's why they call it inflation. So to get inflation under control is to make it harder for us to get this money, because we're already saturated with money. But why would we get more money? So the Federal Reserve says, no, we're going to raise the loan, reduce, or we're going to raise the rate that you have to borrow money, so you will not be so quick to borrow money, so that the supply chain can catch up and reduce inflation. So this whole thing about inflation, when I look at it compared to scripture, it's always been a supply and a demand. Always. Look at the children of Israel coming through the wilderness. They needed food. Big demand, but no food. Then God decides, of course, Jehovah, well, we're going to give you quail in the morning. We're going to give you manna. So they were happy. But they were instructed, just eat what, get what you need for this one day. Do not try to go out and grab all the quail and all the manna and put it in your tent and save it for tomorrow. I know you got a shortage, but God is trying to tell them, I will meet your need tomorrow. You take what you need for today. And what some of them did, they didn't trust God. They decided that they would just take the bread or the manna and hide it in their tent. And guess what? It was molded and it was corrupted and they could not eat it. And what God was telling them, I know there is a demand for food, but I will supply your daily need. That's why he said, give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day, not tomorrow. Give us this day our daily bread. God wants us to know, even though we call it inflation, which is really the economist's term, it's the old-fashioned famine. But God is telling us today that, look, I will supply all of your needs, even though we are in, quote, a famine. Now, some of the political figures today, they didn't want the stimulus checks, but there's a lot of persons that were in need, and the poverty rate, because of the stimulus checks, the poverty rate went down. But the danger was, and this is what some of the politicians were saying about giving all the money, because it'll be excess funds available in the economy, but no productivity. So now we have all this money. We do. But we have no supply. That's inflation. When the demand is greater than the supply, so what you have on hand costs more. It's not that it's worth what it is, but we don't have no other choice. So is it a famine or is it inflation? Right now, I call it a gasoline famine because it's rationed, we pay for it, but it's not as plentiful as it used to be. And the reason why we're talking about this tonight is because even though we are looking at this, it's something that God has always used in the past to get his people to recognize that I don't care how bad the situation is, I can and I will provide. But God has lessons attached to every famine, every situation, everything we go through. Israel's problem was the Old Testament. They did not worship God. They worshiped images. They worshiped false gods. And the punishment for Israel was for God to send a famine so he can get their attention, because he told them, if you don't obey and worship me, I'm going to send the famine. And when the famine came, then they realized, oh my God, God, Jehovah, is trying to teach us something. So then they would repent and God would lift the famine and they would go on. Then later on, they do more sin. God sends more judgment, particularly in the book of Judges. They sin, they repented, God forgave, they sinned again, repented, God. It's just a vicious cycle. So you look at where we are today, inflation is the highest it's been in years. And I'm just wondering myself, is there a lesson in this? Because we've gotten to the place where we depend so much on our earthly resources that comes from God. And every now and then, I believe that God sends something to get our attention. So we have and there's all types of famines. We got I call it a gasoline shortage. We had a shortage in baby formula. Right now there's a shortage of sales in the housing market. There's a shortage. Why? Because the demand is greater than the supply. But when we look at God, and this is a short lesson tonight, when we look at God, God never runs out of what we need. Doesn't matter if it's a famine here or inflation, when the need is great and the supply is limited, God always meets the demand for his people. That's why even today, with the economy the way it is, our faith ought not be in the fuel and the gasoline industry. Because God has a way of letting us know, I'm in charge. All of that fuel, all that gasoline, all of that comes from the ground. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So when God gets ready, when he feels that the lesson is learned, he still redeems his people and redeems you and I right now in the midst of everything that's going on. God meets all of our needs. That's why we should not depend on what happens in Washington as a believer. We can't get hung up on when the prices of gas coming down. It's going to be what it's going to be. We shouldn't stop coming to church. Gas is too high. We shouldn't stop doing good to our neighbors. We still should not cut off doing what we know God has instructed us to do, because the economy should not control what we do for God. We have jobs, we have income, and some persons say, well, I would help the poor, I would help the needy, but I don't know what the economy is going to be, so I'm just going to keep it all for myself. Like the Israelites did, they took all the manna, they took all the bread and they put it in their tent, and then when they went to use it, it was poof. We can't heap all these things up for ourselves. The Bible says, don't lay up treasure for yourself where thieves and moth come in and destroy. Much as we, some of us have so much stuff that we go to get it or to use it, we find it corrupt. We find it ragged and frail. Why? Because what good is it to hold on to it? Because we say times are bad and I don't know what tomorrow is going to be. This is a rainy day or whatever. God takes care of his people. If you got to do something for somebody, do it. Don't let the economy judge how you should respond to what God has commissioned us to do. Now, if I look at God and all the things that we need, we can never go to God and he said, well, right now, we have a shortage in the universe. God doesn't say that. Right now, well, I can't come now. I got to finish lighting up some stars. The demand in the universe is greater than you. I've got to keep the planets from running into each other. So that's a bigger demand. And meanwhile, God doesn't do that. When we call on him, he shows up. And I want the church and all of us to know tonight, be not weary. Don't get discouraged because of these inflation, because of the economy. God is in charge. And if God is in charge, he has enough supply. He has enough grace. He has enough healing. He has enough anointing. On Sunday, we heard a message and we have enough. God has equipped us to meet every need, every desire, everything he's called us to do. We've got to do it in the name of Jesus, and we can't hide under the fact or be shy about going forward because of the economy. Whatever God has called you to do, don't let the economy be a reason why you don't do what you are called to do, or I don't do what God has called me to do. Inflation or no inflation, God is the one that supplies all of our needs. So if you think about that, and I think about that, doesn't matter. If we feel we are in need, then we can go to God. Things running low, we can go to God. Things seem like it's not going to happen. You low on grace, you low on patience. It's not a famine in God's kingdom. The famine is with us. We need to ask God, and God will replenish our supply. So when we look at this world today, yeah, inflation's here. It's real. That's true. But it's not for the believer. God will take care of the believer. And that's what I'm trying to say. Whether it's a inflation, or is it a spiritual famine? Which leads me to the last point. The Bible talks about a time when there will be a spiritual famine in the land. And I don't want to talk about any religion, any church, but there is, and it appears to be now, that the word of God, there's a famine. People don't want to hear the gospel. They don't want to hear about salvation. And because they shut their ears and they don't want to hear, then you wonder why sometimes things happen. He sends a famine to, if people don't want to hear the word of God and they reject it time and time again, there's going to come a time they want to hear and they're not going to be able to. You know why? Because it tells us in Matthew 24, for nations will rise against nation. And think about where we are, and kingdom against kingdom, Matthew 24 and 7. And look, and there will be famines. There will be famines. and we talk about famines. I know we look at it as lack of food, but famine for the word, famine, a shortage of the gospel, a shortage of our prayer lives. There will be famines. Look, pestilence. COVID, a type of. Now we got this new disease. All I'm trying to say is time is winding up. Earthquakes in various places. And the Bible says in Matthew 24, these are the beginning of sorrows. So don't be discouraged because of inflation. Don't be discouraged because of the gross product is down. Don't be discouraged because we can't get what we need from society. This is a time for us to depend on God. If the church doesn't stand up now, we need to, like never before, stop complaining. Stop, and I say this for myself and all of us, stop complaining. Do what God has commanded you to do. Go where God has ordered you to go. And don't we dare hold back on our mission because of what's going on in the country. A true believer says, for God I'll live and for God I'll die. I want you to be encouraged tonight. Yep, we're in the middle of inflation. Now that we understand it, now we know what's going on with it. But it's really a time for the believers to say, I'm anchored in Christ. My faith is in the Word. My faith is in Jesus Christ. Heaven and earth might pass away, but His Word is still there. He promised never to leave me. He promised He'll stay with me. He promised to meet every need. He told me, greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. We are good. We are God's people, and He's looking after us. Now we as a believer have to reach out and walk in our anointing and claim our word, claim our victory. Denounce Satan in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We can do this. Be encouraged. Be encouraged. Yeah, inflation. Yeah. But guess what? It's also a spiritual famine. Nobody. Who stands up in the White House? Who stands up in the government? Who stands up and say repent? Who stands up and say we need God? It's a famine in the land. Be encouraged, persons, in the name of Jesus. Father God, thank you for our lesson tonight. Thank you for lifting us, lifting our awareness, bringing us into an area of relativeness where we can look at what's going on. And through all of that, we can see you. Help us not to become discouraged because of a famine or inflation. You did it before. You'll do it again. In Jesus' name we pray. We pray for the Biden administration, the leaders of our nation. We pray. For God, our hope is in you. Not in legislation, but in you. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted. Amen.
no problem. I'm never sorry that my love cannot solve.
Be encouraged.